You know what this episode also had a lot of? Montages.
Oh.
It was a big montage episode. Sam's training montage with the shield.
Oh, that seemed, we tackled that a little bit about how much he was throwing it. It seemed, right. It seemed excessive. It seemed right. Like, I felt like they were trying to explain, I don't know what they were trying to do. It just seemed, like it seemed
him getting good, him getting good at it. Welcome to the ITE podcast.
This episode is sponsored by the previous episode.
Which was sponsored by the previous episode before that.
I don't even know if you could hear what I said.
What? Look.
Welcome to the
ITE podcast. Is today going to be a weird one?
That's already off the rails.
Yeah.
Welcome to the Is This The Entertainment, the podcast.
Welcome to the Is The This the entertain. Oh gosh, I can't even keep that up. That was hard. I was trying to make a The Falcon and The Winter Soldier.
No, it's
joke.
Fine. Welcome to Success Programs for Executives.
Xantax.
Xantax.
Welcome. Welcome. Hey man, how you doing?
It's good. I got a birthday coming up. You got a birthday coming up. We're getting
Taurus season.
We're getting old.
I've had a lingering back problem for 3 weeks. Yeah.
Jeez.
A lot of time on the floor.
Get off my lawn. Oh man, goodness, I've been having the COVID ear ring. You know what's weird? Is it's every night at 10:15 PM.
Yeah.
It just starts going nuts. Just starts going at the same time. Yeah, it's like it's literally a clock.
Interesting.
Yeah, it is the weirdest thing ever. And then also, if you want to get into tinfoil hat land, when I turn the microwave on, it also rings. So that's a lot of fun. Good times. So yeah, maybe now I'm officially crazy. So
hey. Jacob's been microchipped. It's official. It happened.
Oh my god.
We have confirmation.
I'm just done. I'm so done. I'm so ready. I'm so ready to go move to the beach. Mm-hmm. I can put my cash tag in the description if you want to send me some cash. I am ready to go. If any of the 30 listeners has some extra cash they want to throw my way, sponsor my exodus.
Help get ahead. Jacob out of the country. Nice.
Yeah. What are we talking about?
Let's see. So let's talk about The Nanny starring Fran Drescher.
Let's not.
No? Okay, great. All right.
No, the only thing I remember about The Nanny was like, oh, I bet that show looks really funny. And then I think I tried to watch it and her voice is a level of annoying and grating that only a chalkboard and nails can supersede.
But that's part of the charm, Jacob. That's part of the charm of the show is that
I already have ear ringing problems. Yeah. I'll be skipping that one. But if you're finding some joy in it, I'm not going to insult
you. We're not here to take joy away from people.
Yeah. If it makes you happy, do you.
What's interesting about it, so we started watching it because it's on HBO Max, and it was like, we need a, after the serious show, we need a palate cleansing. If I fall asleep on the couch to this show, I don't miss anything.
It's a shame that you have to pay extra to get a lighthearted, funny show now. Like, all of the shows by default are, like, so depressing.
Yeah, so, yeah, and there aren't a lot of, like,
it's not a lot of levity. Yeah.
There's not a lot of current, like, palate cleansing shows. But then there's also something to be said about if it is a current show, I want to be awake for it. But if it's The Nanny, or if I'm rewatching Parks and Rec, or if I'm rewatching Schitt's Creek, then I can, like, nod off for 15 of guilty, the 23 minutes, and I don't feel bad. And then the episode's over, I hear the music, and then I'm like, oh, time to walk the dog and go to bed. So that's how The Nanny has happened to me. Mm-hmm. And
I can't believe you can fall asleep with that voice in the background, but hey.
Pretty much anything. Yeah, oh, definitely, definitely. Oh my gosh. You know what? If in high school, when we were doing rehearsals for Crazy for You, a tap dance show, I would take a nap because my character didn't do any dancing until the like finale. So in the dance rehearsals, I had to be there, but I didn't have to do much. So I would just take a nap on the floor that everyone was tap dancing on.
That's pretty impressive.
So that's a point of pride for me that I was able to fall asleep to happening on the floor. So
you should get an award for that or something. You sure you don't
have? Or maybe it's like sleep apnea during the night and it's been a constant thing to where I can fall asleep anyway because I'm missing out on REM sleep. Who knows? Only until I decide to go to a doctor will we ever find out.
Yeah.
So watching The Nanny actually reminds me
You've never fallen asleep during a podcast, so.
I have not done that. That's because I drink a lot of coffee before and during the podcast.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm up to cup three, and I'll probably go make a cup four here in a minute. This is the
cup two, and I'm also balancing it out with some water. So
Yeah, I got the water. I got the water.
Gotta stay neutral.
Ooh,
which is interesting to me how this like late '90s three camera sitcom is so much more like live theater than a single cam show. Like it's if this is the spectrum, like theater single cam show. That three camera is like over here.
Yeah.
It's crazy, man. There's so much and here's a joke to the audience.
Speaking of three camera shows, did you see the new Jamie Foxx three camera show on Netflix?
No, I saw that it exists, but I haven't watched it yet. Is it good? Have you checked it out?
It's like a little awkward. Like they're playing to the audience like a little too soon. Like they're not. I don't know. It's like the they're not taking there. The time to build up the characters or anything. They're just like, hi, winky wink. That's okay. Right. What's going on here? What's the story? Hold on a second. I feel like it's going to have a lot of comedy and stuff in it, but it feels like they're really trying real hard. And
right.
I'm hopeful. I hope it's funny, but I don't know if I'm going to give it another shot. I think we got about 15 minutes into the first episode. And we're like, this is...
Right.
We both agreed this is trying too hard, but there were some moments that were funny.
Cool.
Yeah.
I feel like what you're describing with the Jamie Foxx show, what I'm describing with The Nanny is probably more true to form for the three cam show or to maybe what it was originally. Seinfeld also being a three camera show, but if Seinfeld were made today, it would be a single cam 100%.
Yeah.
So I feel like it broke the form and maybe makes everything after it feel like disingenuous, maybe
because
it's not played out to the audience for laughs, like the laughs are between the characters and it's very much like what's happening between the characters right then and there, and it's not like all wink wink nudge nudge the way that other stuff is I don't know, I could be wrong.
That just fell off a cliff. Our one viewer just left.
Yeah. Yes. Goodbye.
Thanks for joining. I hope you hit the like button on your way out. Yeah.
Well, hey, speaking of Seinfeld.
Well, I thought you were going to have a punchline, a joke coming.
No. It was. That's no, it. I was. No, really. Just did Seinfeld break the three camera show?
Maybe. Yeah. Because that's kind of what I remember of it. And like, I remember Friends. In Friends, they didn't play to the camera.
True. Yeah, they didn't play to the camera. It was all interpersonal stuff.
So part of my experience watching three camera shows growing up was not a lot of, hey, wink. There wasn't a lot. Right. Except for maybe Fresh Prince of Bel-Air had a bit of it.
Big Bang Theory, do they do that much? I feel like I haven't watched a whole lot of it, but I don't feel like they do a lot of like to the audience kind of stuff.
I have a hard time watching Big Bang Theory.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I can't. It's like...
All right.
I don't understand why. I don't understand how you can take a show like that, and it just feels so stereotypical. Okay, let's have stereotypical nerds make stereotypical nerd jokes, and everybody will love it. And it's just like anytime you put somebody in like a very stereotypical box, it bothers me. And maybe it's because
I feel like that's what three camera shows do. I feel like that's part of it, like.
Maybe
Steve Urkel was the nerd. What was the Olsen twins were the cute ones, even though they were one character. Uncle Jesse was the cool one. Uncle Joey was the funny one.
Yeah. And that's to me, that's how much storytelling has evolved, though. We expect a deeper layer of character now. Like it can't just be a stereotypical thing. Yeah.
So in a world where three camera is closer to theater, then it kind of lives more in that like giant broad like almost caricature type characters.
Right. Yeah, I'm not disagreeing. Why I don't like it. Maybe that's
three camera doesn't work anymore. It's because like if you are watching a three camera, you have to think of it through the filter of I'm watching a theatrical production as opposed to I'm watching a realistic show, because single cam can do real so much better.
Speaking of theatrical production and not realistic shows, let's talk about The Falcon and the Winter Soldier, episode five.
Man, actually, can we talk about the fight first? Because that was like right
out. Know this one.
Yeah, you got it right there. Yeah, just no talking about it. Just, dude, what just happened? It was like, hey man, you screwed up. It's gonna be okay. But how about you give us that shield?
Because yeah, I really,
I'm gonna need you to drop the shield.
Yeah,
you
I love the tax they had there. Yeah. I'm just interrupting you. No, this is going to be one of those shows. It's going to be one of those shows.
It's going to be a choppy one. Yeah, I liked that they just picked it right up from where it ended. And then Sam putting his foot down and me, you don't get to have that anymore, because now it's full of blood. It's not what that's for.
Yeah, and they didn't. I think it's great that they handled it right there, like they should. Mm-hmm. But they could have just been like, "Hey," and called the military or whatever, or whoever.
Oh, that's what I thought.
Whoever's in charge right now, who we don't really know who's in charge of Captain America exactly, but they could have called that person.
Definitely. Who's his commanding officer?
Yeah, exactly.
Like, that person needed to be informed.
Should have been let in.
Yeah.
Be like, hey, we got to do this thing. We got to. But you know what? On the flip side, they probably were informed because of all the social media posts going around.
Oh, they found out about it real quick. Yeah. Somebody was on a plane by that point. Somebody was like, oh, I'm on my way to Latvia because we need to bring homeboy in, because it ain't. Yeah.
I just don't understand the shield throwing and why it doesn't kill people. Can somebody explain that to me?
The physics of the shield
are baffling. We saw it here and later in the show where Falcon's playing Frisbee with himself. Like, how can he throw it that fast, that hard? He's not a super dude.
It makes me think, my perception of the shield and its physics has been completely reliant on the idea that Steve Rogers is a super soldier. So he can fling this thing with such velocity. And seeing Sam do it, and, you know, to a lesser extent, John Walker do it, makes me think that it makes me rethink the physics of the shield itself and puts more of the emphasis on the vibranium and less emphasis on the strength of the thrower.
You're throwing a Frisbee that seems self-propelled in a way. Yeah. So it really doesn't make sense.
Yeah, it definitely puts the onus more on the vibranium for it being, it must be just like super light,
except they show like how heavy it is.
It's like light but durable, if that makes sense.
Yeah, like it before, like the Falcon, like he was like having a hard time carrying it around earlier. Yeah, when he picked it up in a couple episodes ago, it was like how are you gonna just fling that thing around? It's a paper airplane or whatever. I don't know. Christ.
And also, is that a motion that the human body is supposed to do? It's like baseball players. The human arm is not supposed to throw a baseball 95 miles per hour 120 times in a day, every 5 days for 5 months. So all these guys end up having to get a very specific surgery. They have to get Tommy John surgery all the time because the human body is not supposed to do that thing. So like, is there a thing where, oh yeah, you can throw that for about a year, but then you're going to have some rotator.
You know what it makes me wonder? Issue. This is something weird. This just occurred to me. What if there was another vial? What if Falcon took a vial?
Nah.
He's throwing this thing like he's like it just doesn't. The logic.
Anthony Mackie's arms are pretty jacked. They show his jacked arms in this episode.
That's true. Yeah we got to show this. They didn't show so much of the shield flying through the air at like mock speed. I just wish they would have been
just have to make that switch in your mind that this is the vibranium. It's the vibranium that makes this possible and not inherent.
The shield was not an offensive thing. It wasn't a thing. Like, it's a shield. Mm-hmm. It should just be a shield, like a defense thing and a symbol for Captain America. Why can't it just be a shield? You know what I mean? Why you gotta throw
also, it? Also, if the main thing is it absorbs the energy, right? So like when somebody hits it, it absorbs the energy. When he flings it, and it hits a tree, shouldn't it just absorb the energy and drop to the ground from that point?
The entire show breaks. Falcon could have sent out some tweets. He could have got the GoFundMe.
Could have called Pep. Pep could have funded that boat in a minute.
So many things could have happened.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Pepper could have paid for that.
This show is in an alternate timeline. This is in an alternate comic book universe that is not the same as the one it started in, I don't think.
I don't know, man. I'm pretty sure we could pick apart all of the other movies.
Oh, yeah. They all start falling apart. And 5 years, people are gone, and then they show back up.
Half the times Tony Stark got flung around in that suit, it's not like that suit can absorb everything.
Right.
Like, yeah, the suit might stop your body from going...
Your head doesn't roll off, hit the wall or whatever. Yeah,
right. Like, exactly. Yeah. Like your brain still slid up against the side of your skull at that force.
I get out of my car and I hit my head on the ceiling, that hurts. That's mm-hmm. still going on inside right. of that suit. Yeah. The physics of the show. I think, man, I hope Marvel's coming to a point where it just says fuck it and just resets everything.
No way. Like, why would they do that? They've built 30 movies worth of content. Like, they're not gonna...
I know, but they had the event. They had a climactic event with Endgame, and everything from here on out is just the sort of trailing off of whatever. Like, stuff's messed up.
No, what's fun about, at least from the side of the Disney Plus shows, we haven't seen much from a movie standpoint other than the newer Spider-Man movie, which is its own weird Sony MCU monster. But with the Disney Plus shows, we really get so much more character development. We get the conversations that you can't have in a 2.5-hour movie.
Yeah, the whole Scarlet Witch thing. Yeah, but like the problem is like people, we don't really get the sense that Scarlet Witch is a bad person. Like even mm-hmm. though she held an entire town hostage. And like just left off the hook for that.
I don't know if there will be like straight repercussions, but
it's just like our sense of morality, our moral compass is as a population is so off, because I was completely forgiving of her. I had to like in retrospect think about this and go, oh, wait a minute. That's really messed up that she did that. You know what I mean? There should be consequences for forcing people to stand outside for 8 hours or whatever. That's not a nice thing to do.
No, of course not.
Yeah.
And I think a lesser show wouldn't have addressed that at all. You know what I mean? A lesser show wouldn't have shown like her walking out of the town and everybody like
being upset,
hating her with their faces as she walks away. But then also scared of her because they're like, I don't want to piss you off,
right?
But I also hate you.
Like in retrospect, what they've done though is they've villainized the guy trying to do the right thing. You know what I mean? The guy that was like Hayward or Wayward or whatever his name is. Like he was trying.
Yeah.
He knew she was doing bad shit, obviously. So mm-hmm. he's like trying to take her out.
But he also like there's a certain
His vision thing is totally
thing was completely self-serving and I wonder how much of him being like we're gonna take out Wanda is also to keep her out of Vision, like his Vision project. And I don't know, because his other actions are self-serving, I feel like that's it.
And your point is well taken here, because this is what I'm talking about. This is good TV. Like WandaVision was good TV because the characters are so multifaceted and have good and bad sides. Mm-hmm. Like every single character had that. And that is awesome to me. And this show, it's starting to address that with the Captain America or US agent or John Walker. Like they're mm-hmm. trying to show his good sides a little bit in this. Like they were talking about, hey, you made me this. Like that was pretty powerful stuff. Like I was like, definitely. He's got a point. You turned him into this thing. This was what you wanted him to be.
Yeah.
With all that military experience, like you can't really be surprised that he did what he did. You know what I mean?
Yeah, this show, it's all of those character moments, and it really does dive into like how multifaceted everybody is. Bucky's obviously dealing with all of his murdery past stuff mm-hmm. and trying to come out of that, trying to figure out who he is as a person, who he is when when Steve isn't around, trying to figure that out. Zemo, we all came into this thinking Zemo was going to be the big bad and just like bad to the bone kind of a thing. And Zemo's turned out to be this like real kind of like sympathetic,
likable character.
Yeah. And, definitely likable,
which is weird. And it's because my wife's like, why don't they just let him go? I'm like, he blew up the UN.
Oh yeah, he kind of blew up the UN, and he killed, I mean, he definitely killed T'Challa, and obviously the Wakandans are still upset. Yeah, but they present him with the opportunity to make himself a super soldier, and he stays, you know, true to his core of I don't believe in this, and starts smashing vials.
Yeah, like he could have took it and got everybody freed himself. Every other person probably watching would have taken it. Everybody would have taken it and gotten themselves off the hook. And this guy, you're right, man. Like his character is so, I don't know, thought provoking, I guess is the word.
Right. And then you've got Carly Morgenthau. She's trying to get people to pay attention to her cause, but going about it in a way that is
terroristy,
ultra violent, super violent, and she's getting like each episode she gets a little bit more radicalized thing, like with her mentality. So it's
the show was shot a while ago, right? Like 2 years ago or something, 3 years ago.
I have no idea. Actually, I don't know.
Yeah,
it's because I know that WandaVision was disrupted by COVID, so it makes me think that this was similar, like around that same time frame. So maybe some of it was and some of it wasn't. I don't really know.
It's just the way that I guess history just continues to repeat itself. It's just the same over and over. Like we just see the same things over and over, same stories. Granted, it's different for sure, but it's
I'm trying to think of like the context of the show and like dealing with the like the ramifications of the blip and how people would fall through the cracks. You know what I mean? But I feel like the blip, like it was freeing for certain people because now half of the world's jobs are open and available and half the world's houses are open and available. So I rewatched episode 4 and there was a line because I remember you were saying like, I wish they explained a little bit more. So there was a line about when all these people disappeared, countries were scrambling to fill jobs so I guess like normal immigration wasn't a thing. It was just kind of like open borders, like you need a job, we need to fill these jobs because otherwise these systems start to collapse. We need somebody to make sure that the boats at the dock, that the shipping, or the power plant doesn't melt down because we don't have enough people monitoring or whatever the case is. So I think it turned from almost to like this point, only without the like resources part, but I guess it was like open season on just like opportunity for growth. And then when billions of people reappear and then they're like, there's some people living in my house and they've been living there for 3 years. So then how do you deal with like, all right, who gets that house? And then does the person who's been living there for 3 years get kicked out? And then they end up in this like resettlement camp and then people fall through the cracks. It's just an interesting concept. Whereas, what is it? Far From Home, Spider-Man Far From Home. It's just, they talk about the blip for 2 seconds and then they're like, all right, everybody's back in high school. Some of them are older. Some of them are still the same age. Moving on.
Don't try to explain this. Not a whole lot of like
consequences there. Yeah. And then the people who are 5 years older, did they just suspend school for 5 years? I feel like that's a little, I feel like 3 years in, they probably got schools reopened somewhere.
Yeah.
In the Bronx, or is it Bronx? No, it's Queens. In Queens, they've got school figured out.
Zoom classes. You know what I saw? This is completely off topic, but I saw a commercial for University of Louisville, but they teach like most of the classes on Zoom now.
And, oh, yeah.
And to me, that's freaking nuts. Like, you're paying like $35,000 a year for what is it now? It's probably per semester, right? It's small fee.
I think it's eight.
$8,000 per semester. That's in state, right?
Yeah, something like that. Yeah.
$8,000 to take 20 hours worth of classes on Zoom. Like,
a lot of schools have been going to like online degree programs to get people from like out of state. Like, the online degree programs have like exponentially gotten just like exponential growth for those.
But what I'm saying is think of what you can do for $8,000. That's just one semester. if you spent $8,000 on, like, you could go to Tony Robbins, you know what I'm saying? Like, you could do the whole fire walk, get a nice hotel, go take a vacation, right, come back, you know.
If you're working for a job and you're making 60 grand a year, and then you go and get that MBA, which you do online because you're still working full time, and then all of a sudden you can get promoted to a job that's $120,000 a year, and it's going to pay for itself pretty soon. Yeah, I think that's the flexibility in time is partially why I think these online degree programs are just exploding. Somebody like University of Phoenix Online used to be like a joke to people, but now people see it on a resume and they're like, yeah, sure. Did you do the work? Do you got the skills? Awesome. And there's other schools recreating that. One of my sisters has a degree from like Gonzaga, lives in Kentucky. Gonzaga's in the Pacific Northwest, Washington State.
No idea.
I think she had to fly there one time.
Right. Yeah. No, I'm not arguing against if your job requires you to have a certain thing. Yeah, that makes sense. But it's just strange. Like, they never tell you growing up, hey, the fastest way to make a raise, get a different job. Nobody ever tells you that.
Yeah, for our parents, it was get a job and stay there forever and get that pension. And I feel like now it's you want a raise, you got to hop to another job, yep, and just keep hopping up and, yeah, up and up and up.
Up the ladder that way. Yeah, yeah. But nobody tells you that. Like, it's just...
You know. I also think it's evolving. And, you know, I think some of it's also like regional. Like, the types of jobs we can get here in Kentucky are different from elsewhere, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
For instance, right now in Kentucky, there's a million warehouse shipping, what do you call it?
Fulfillment centers.
Yes, fulfillment centers. There's a billion fulfillment centers because of UPS's hub and because we're pretty centrally located to where you can get most of this half of the United States in a day. If you live in Philadelphia, there's some different jobs. There isn't a whole lot of fulfillment jobs. All right. Let's get into the big reveal. Is it a big reveal? I don't know, man.
It feels like a big reveal.
It feels like a big reveal. She's a big deal. Bringing in an actor of this caliber, Julia Louis-Dreyfus, dropping in after the John Walker Senate firing.
Somebody said she was a character in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Like, this character was in... Was she?
No. There was a character that was similar. Yeah. So I read an article because I was like, I need to find out more.
Yeah.
So from a comic book standpoint, this character has been three things primarily. One, a S.H.I.E.L.D. agent who has had on again, off again relations with Nick Fury. So they got a dynamic together. Also, with the Hydra S.H.I.E.L.D. reveal, she has also been the head of Hydra, taking over the mantle of Lady Hydra, which is a great name. Also, the third thing is that she has been the head of a group called Leviathan, which, if you watched the Agent Carter show, that was a like mid-season Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. So this Leviathan thing is interesting because it kind of ties into the Black Widow program with high-powered lady assassins.
Yeah, I heard a rumor. I don't even think it's a rumor. I'm pretty sure this character is in...
Yeah, I think she's in the Black Widow movie. Yeah.
And I think it was supposed to come before this. So we're getting like a weird...
So this was supposed to be like reveal. A big tie-in, and now it's going to be a backwards tie-in. That'll be fun. Yeah, but I do like that, like, here's my card. There's nothing on this. That's such a boss move.
Yeah, we'll call you. We'll call you.
Yeah. Man, like, bringing in a big dog with JLD here. That's a big move.
I feel like she's aged all right. She looks about the same.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, how old is she? She's got to be in her, like... late 50s, early 60s.
I think like 60. Yeah.
Yeah. And she went through cancer.
Oh, okay. Well, that's no fun.
So tag that on there. She looks doubly amazing. But she was on SNL in the 80s.
Yeah, man. Like, she's really been around a while. Yeah. And she's aging. Yeah, 60 years old, looking like that. Yeah.
Which, you know, for Sam Jackson, samesies. Sam Jackson he's always looked 47 years old. He was in his 20s, he looked 47. He's in his 60s, he looks 47. Sam Jackson always looks 47.
Yeah. He's gotten a little scrawnier. But
yeah, you know.
Can't win them all.
Yep, absolutely. He's coming for us all.
I know. It's scary.
It's coming from my lower back first before anything else.
Getting older just really makes you like realize, oh, I need to do something. I need to eat better. I need to exercise. Yeah, I need to take care of myself. Holy crap. What have I been doing? Yeah.
I got to stop eating rallies.
Oh, bro. You got
to
eat.
When I do go to rallies, I need to not order the most disgusting thing I can see. And that was a point of pride for a long time. I would like the greasy bacon thing.
Yeah.
What's the grossest thing on the menu? Like the grossest looking but best tasting thing on the menu?
Yeah.
I'll have that. Can you add chili? I'll have it.
Make sure you put extra sauce. Yeah. On there.
Sauces. Everything's a vessel for sauce.
It's just more vegetable oil. Mayonnaise is vegetable oil. And you find out vegetable oil is not good for you.
Right.
Yeah. After we grew up learning, oh, vegetable oil is good for you. It's from vegetables. How can it be bad? Oh, it causes heart attacks and cancer? Jesus. It's terrible. Terrible. What are you supposed to do? Everything's backwards.
Cook with lard. Lard.
You're actually probably really more on point than you think you are. Yeah.
No, when I fry chicken, I like to do a mixture of lard and I'll do the vegetable oil. When I fry the chicken, most of the time I'm an olive oil guy. That's my everyday workhorse. Yeah, and at this point, I'm doing some.
I have to go look and see what kind of oil I have. It's a weird one. We were doing rice bran oil for a minute and we ran out. And then we got, I want to say it's grapeseed oil, but I'm not even sure that's what it is. I don't think it is.
Okay.
It's a weird one. Yeah.
My uncle, he's pretty active on Twitter and is all about that keto life. Yeah. And so one of the guys that he retweets a lot is like seed oils are the worst. Like all probably. Seed oils are terrible. Yeah. And then, I have this, like, every time I see that, I have this, am I going to Google whether or not an olive is a seed?
You probably should. Yeah.
Is it?
Cause the problem, you know what I've heard about olive oils is they can call vegetable oil an olive oil if they put like 5% olive oil in it. Like they can still call it. Yeah, they can still call it like 100% olive oil. Mm-hmm. So like you have to get how they have those little bottles of like super expensive olive oil that spoils after like 30 days. Like that's the kind of olive oil you're supposed to get. Oh. Like it's a thing.
Yeah, I might be priced out of that one.
Yeah, but it's your health, man. Like it's funny. You know, we use expensive hand soap from France. Like it's ridiculous. Who thought we would buy $8 for a thing of hand soap? You know how you wash your hands get dry and gross and crackly. Mm-hmm. Ours don't do that from this. Like, some things are just worth spending the extra money on, you know?
I tell you what, bar soap is where I've come. That's where I've landed, is the liquid soaps are a sham to get you to spend more money. Because, man, you can get like a 9-pack of bar soaps, that will last you
forever,
years, plural. Yeah. And that's $3.
Yeah,
you get two pumps and that's $3 and you have to replace them in 3 weeks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And plus there's like tons of chemicals in there. You know, if something kills germs, then it probably kills other things. People don't ever really put those two together. If it's killing germs, what does it do to regular cells? Like people don't put 2 + 2. I feel like there's more of it now. Like people are getting there, but like if it kills 99.99% of something, what is it doing?
Yeah, man,
to
I don't want that antibacterial. Yeah. I just want like regular. Yeah. You know, the stuff that gets through, hopefully it's in a small enough scale to where I can develop immunity to it.
Yeah. What were we talking about before I went down the rabbit hole?
Julia Louis-Dreyfus getting old?
Yeah.
You know what this episode also had a lot of? Montages.
Oh.
It was a big montage episode. Sam's training montage. With the shield.
Oh, we tackled that a little bit about how much he was throwing it. It seemed excessive. Like, I felt like they were trying to explain. I don't know what they were trying to do.
Him getting good at it.
Yeah, like for the future.
I mean, look, this whole episode was like, we're setting up for the finale here. We're going to tie off some of these character loose ends. We're just going to like Zemo. We're going to put him aside. We're going to take care of the Zemo thing, so you're not going to worry about him unless there's a reveal later. You know, Isaiah, we're going to go back to that. We're going to put a button on, like, his kind of role in this story and how it affects Sam.
The button they put on it was like, let's tackle some of these tougher issues here.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely.
So, like, the button they put on it was a black man can't be Captain America ever. That's what Isaiah said.
Yeah, and that's one person's perspective.
For sure.
And it's one person's perspective who's been through, like, these traumatic events. So, you know, all of his traumatic events are informing his thoughts on that. And then,
we don't want to skip this. We don't want to skip this. All of these traumatic events were caused by quote unquote America. The bad guy in this show seems to be America. Like, the new Captain America is bad. The damage done to Isaiah was done by America. It's not a good look. It's not a great look.
I think what the show is trying to do is say it's complicated. And, you know, like, for me, this show is about, I've said it before, you know, this show, the main through line of this show is about Sam taking on the mantle. Like, Sam going from being the Falcon sidekick of Captain America to being the new Captain America. And for him to make that jump, to make that leap, we all have to watch Sam reconcile with some stuff. You know what I mean?
And it should be known too that, like, most of the stuff that Sam is dealing with is internal. It's all like an internal having to address his limiting beliefs or mental obstacles.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. If every episode from now on has mental obstacles / limiting beliefs.
Success programs for executives.
For executives, exactly. Then we have done a great job.
Yeah.
If that happens, I'm perfectly fine with that.
I'm super happy that it's tackling it this way. It's all an internal battle. It's all in his head. And I'm not sure that's the intention. I think they meant to make it like, hey, society is this way. But what's really happening is it isn't. It's really in his mind. And I think that's really powerful. Like, society, yeah, it's effed up sometimes, but we're coming from a place where in real life we did have a black president. So really, what's holding you back? Oh, it's yourself.
It's himself, but it's also like other people's perceptions, other people's, how other people see him. Like, those things factor in, you know? What I like is that he's getting all of these perspectives from, he's getting Bucky's perspective on things. He's getting Zemo's perspective on things. He's getting Isaiah's perspective on things. And that's helping him inform whether or not he's going to take this leap and be Captain America. And then what's also nice is that we continue to see that what Steve Rogers saw in him as having a high moral compass, Sam has stayed with. He's continued with that throughout this journey, whereas other people have not.
Although John, it's questionable Walker, that, you know, he wanted to speak with Carly after she committed, like, murder. Like, that to me is a little off. Like, it should have been in a reverse order, maybe. Like, you know, tried to talk to her before would have made more sense. So I don't know if that was, like, retroactively put in, oh, we should have him talk.
Honestly, I think it was more so I think it was a couple of different things. I think it was a way to show Sam versus John Walker, like, to show, like, their differing tactics there, because Walker wanted to go in guns blazing and Sam wants to go in and talk her down. And let's see if we can settle this without more people dying.
Yeah.
Because when you got a bunch of super soldiers, more people are going to die. And John Walker went in there and now some people are dead. So that's a bummer.
That's a great point. The line that Bucky says.
Oh, where he was like, Steve and I didn't really understand the implications of what you taking up the shield meant, something like that. Like,
yeah,
there's some sort of line, like, yes, the implications, like, we didn't really think about what that would mean, what kind of, like, internal struggle you would have with that. I think it was what he was going for with that line.
Yeah, I think he's implying, like, a societal struggle, but I think the thing that we are seeing is that it is more an internal struggle than, and that's something to you can't have success programs for executives without overcoming your mental obstacles. And I'll be very proud of the Falcon if he overcomes his mental obstacles and becomes the Captain America that we all would love to see him be, or that I would love to see him be. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. No, I mean, this series for me has been about him having to, like, reconcile with the weight of taking on Captain America and the journey that he has to go on to kind of piece all of that together. And I think they've done a really good job of kind of setting the table for all of the differing kind of like reasons, plus what the pros and the cons, what the pros and the cons of doing that are, like how that's going to affect him, how that's going to affect the world, whether or not he thinks he would be accepted, whether or not, any number of options.
And, so, and does he want to be with America having this like bad,
like, yeah. Does, yeah.
Does he want
to
be that?
Is that something he wants to subscribe to? Yeah. And then there's that whole whether or not Captain America is an actual function of the military, or which
I believe so. Like I believe Steve, Captain America was originally, well, yeah, he was created as like a super soldier in the military, right, and like a propaganda machine. Type. Yeah.
Steve bucked that and said, no, I'm gonna do me. So I think
it could be some sort of amalgamation of all of it.
Yeah, I think Sam can do that similarly and just keep on with that Avenger life. Sure, what is the status of the Sokovia Accords at this point? Do we know? Do the Sokovia Accords still exist?
I think so. Yeah. So there has to be some kind of agreement, right? Yeah.
Yeah. I wonder, are the Avengers still together? Is that a thing? What's Hulk doing? I don't know.
Who knows? Yeah. Why didn't he show up? Where's everybody else?
I got some policy questions. Yeah.
Back to the legal drawing board, boardroom meeting.
Absolutely.
We need more of that. Yeah.
We need a boardroom montage is what we need. Yeah, we got a fixing the boat montage in this episode.
Oh yeah. Yeah. That was, I like that. I like that the community came together to help him.
Yeah, that was nice.
And I think they would have done it sooner if they had known, you know, that's what I'm saying. Right. Just let somebody know you need some help.
Lean on your community, man. Lean on your community. Yeah.
And it was cool that Bucky was there helping out and hitting on his sister. That was fun. Yeah.
That was hilarious. As soon as like he walked in and she gave him a glance, I was like, this is going to be a thing. And I love it. And then it became more and more of a thing. And it was hilarious. That was wonderful.
Yeah.
That was great.
Hey, real life stuff, man. Yeah. And I wonder, Bucky seems okay now all of a sudden, which is a little weird. I was hoping they would kind of tackle some more of that, like him like making restitution for his things, like
murdering
the
stuff that, ways.
Yeah, his murdery way. Yeah. Yeah. I was hoping to see a little more of that. And maybe
I think we will. I think ultimately, like at the end of this, we're going to see him go tell his nice older friend that he killed his son that one time. Yeah. I think we're going to end up getting that. And that's going to be real sad, but, you know, necessary.
Yeah. I'm looking forward to the way this resolves, and I'm really hoping that it is like it is the mental obstacle that it is, and that he gets over it, and we can see that growth in him. And
I think him opening the case from the Wakandans is him saying it's go time. I'm doing this.
So
weighed all of my options.
So at that point, this show will be doing what a superhero show is probably supposed to do, which is inspire us to be better people. And let's get inspired, let's be better people, and click the link in the description, join the success programs for executives, and
that's right, get we'll rid of your mental week. Subconscious and conscious obstacles, and we'll see you next time. Thanks for listening. Rate and review if you can.
Give us a like, get the thumbs up
on the YouTube, hit us with that.
And if you have something you want us to talk about, or if you think we didn't address something, or you want us to address something, or you don't want us to address something,
if you want us to stop making the podcast,
just let us know.
Be like, call Jacob's cell phone number. It is Duncan.
You probably have it. Just text me and be like, hey, stop talking.
Yeah.
And on that note, I think that's it. I think we're just going to do a short one. And thank you guys. Appreciate you. And thank you, Ben. Thanks for being here. Yeah.
Bye.